Britain is home to some of the most iconic dishes in the world.
Fire!
From fish and chips to pie and mash, afternoon tea to roast beef and Yorkshires.
Now it's time for the roast!
Our national favourites have been hundreds of years in the making.
Whoa!
I want to reveal the untold stories behind them.
Rubs up!
How roast beef fueled the building of an empire. How fish and chips saved us in the war. And how curry changed the face of modern Britain.
I've never had a chilli that hot.
I want to find out why they're so deeply rooted in our culture. I'll be hopping into my time machine to explore their secret histories.
This looks wrong.
Looking for inspiration to create an epic culinary salute.
Let the feast begin!
Now I'm turning my attention to chocolate. I'll explore the origins of our love for the ultimate feel-good treat.
It's beautiful, I think.
Try my hand at creating a new modern classic before staging the most dazzling celebration of the humble cocoa bean that Britain has ever seen.
Who's up for chocolate?
If there's one indulgence we Brits love more than any other, it's chocolate.
India! What are we going to do, Vic?
As a nation, we eat more than 500,000 tonnes of chocolate every year.
I love chocolate. Everyone I know loves chocolate. We just can't get enough of it. So are you a chocolate fan?
Yeah, of course.
I have chocolate every day, I'd say.
Helps you through the bad times. It's comforting.
It makes me happy.
The naughtiness of it, the buzz it gives me.
Best time of year for chocolate, Christmas and Easter.
I want to know why we love chocolate so much. And I also want to discover how it's become so ingrained in our culture. And then, as a salute to this great British favourite, I want to create a three-course chocolate feast.
I love surprising my diners by combining ingredients they'd never expect. And over the years, I've put chocolate with everything from blue cheese to caviar. So, to kick things off at my chocolate feast, I want to serve up an appetizer that mixes chocolate with flavours my diners won't be expecting. So I'm heading back to the birth of the chocolate bar for some inspiration. The British chocolate bar industry was born in 1847 when hot chocolate producers Fry's realised they could do more with chocolate than sell it as a drink. They invented the first ever chocolate bar, with rivals Cadbury's and Roundtree's launching their own bars shortly after. I've come to meet chocolate expert James Maxton, who I'm hoping will tell me more about these early recipes.
This first chocolate bar, did it have any flavourings, or was it just chocolate?
It's just chocolate. Still quite bitter.
Yeah.
Quite grainy. Not like the chocolate you would have now.
Unlike today's sweet treat, the original chocolate bars were marketed as health products, a portable snack to give you energy and keep you active. And in the archive, James has an example of an early bar that did just that.
The product was called Oxchalup.
Made with oxes.
It was chocolate with meat extract.
Oh, so literally made with oxes.
Yes. So at the time, meat extract was seen and had health benefits, as did chocolate as well. I think Roundtree's thought it'd be a good idea to put the two together and make a bar.
Ox chocolate, this is a great name. This is a nourishing confection, pleasant, palatable and sustaining. Composed of the finest chocolate with meat extract in a very concentrated form. And this bit at the bottom is just brilliant. Especially suitable for travellers, cyclists and invalids. Was it just chocolate and meat extract?
I believe that's what it is, yeah.
It sounds a simple enough recipe. With the help of Nestlé's senior confectioner, Vicky Gill, I'm hoping it might inspire my new chocolate bar.
We've got a nice big room at the other end of the kitchen that's heated, so we keep all our liquid chocolate in there.
And this is like a cold room.
It's the opposite. It's a hot room.
It's a hot room. So you just got continual, lifelong, eternal supply of
liquid chocolate.
Okay, so for this experiment, we've just got a modern version of a stock cube, beef or meat extract. And then the idea is just to mix the two together, an incredibly advanced experiment. That might be rather a lot.
I'm used to experimenting with flavours, but this might be a first for me.
My God, that's a lot, isn't it?
You can actually smell that now,
yeah,
whereas you couldn't before.
I got a big whiff of it just then.
Than the extract.
It's just giving it like a salty kick at the finish, isn't it? Almost the flavour's gone deeper, slightly savoury, and then this salty kick at the finish. Now, salt and bitter chocolate work really well together.
The final mix from Vicky, and it's left to set in an antique chocolate bar mould. And 2 hours later, it's ready. Now to test it out on the kind of people the original Oxchulip bar would have been aimed at, fitness fanatics.
I know you're in the middle of a workout.
That's all right.
Can I interest you in the taste? And you can tell me if it's nourishing and what you think of it.
Oh, yeah, I wouldn't be over generous with a bite.
That's good.
Yeah?
Oh, yeah. Salty for some people's taste. Well, that's quite good for endurance because you use a lot of salt.
Something definitely you'd have again.
If it was available, I'd probably use it, yeah.
In that case, I'll let you get the benefit from your ox chocolate. Thanks a lot. Yeah. It's meant to be very nourishing for cyclists.
It's a bit weird tasting. It's like a twang on my tongue afterwards, but it's all right.
Would you like the rest of it?
I'm all right.
Do you feel nourished?
No, I feel like I need to throw up. Not very nice. At all.
Hey, ladies.
Crunchy bistro.
I quite like it, actually. I quite like it.
Crunchy bistro is a good one. Do you feel nourished?
Yeah.
You do? Actually, you just picked up speed. You're going faster now. You're flying around that track.
I'm actually pleasantly surprised. It may not have appealed to everyone, but some people really like that mix of flavours.
If I could have some kind of meaty element, but in such a subtle way that it made the chocolate taste different, but not so obviously meaty, it could be a surprising new chocolate bar.
So, for my appetizer, I'm taking the idea of a meaty chocolate bar and adapting it for today's modern tastes.
So I'm going to base my chocolate bar on an absolute classic. However, I'm going to put a bit of beef in mine, so I'm going to call it a mousse bar. Think about combining two of your favourite fruits, Sunday roast and a chocolate bar.
I'm going to start by making a beefy nougat.
So in here I've got some Wagyu beef that I've roasted to render the fat from it. Pop on the old mixer. So in here I've got some powdered egg white and something called trimaline, which is a bit like glucose. And what that does, it's going to help give the nougat a really smooth texture. So in here, I've got sugar, a bit of malt syrup, and also some Wagyu beef stock. So it's a beefy syrup. I just gradually pour it into this mixture. I'm going to add some of our rendered Wagyu beef fat. The stock made from Wagyu beef with some fat in it and reduced down the very concentrated kind of essence. So to kind of smell the nougat, and I'm getting this really, actually quite wonderful smell of roasted beef. And finally, some cocoa mass that I've melted. This will also give it a nice bitterness, which will just help cut through the richness. It really is quite unusual. It feels like it shouldn't work, but it just does. So just pour it out on a sheet. So I'm just going to pop this in the fridge so it can set. So here, I've got a caramel that's been made with Guinness and some more beef. Lay that on top of the nougat. As you can see now, I'm starting to build up the layers of my chocolate bar.
Having cut the nougat and caramel into bars, I'm laying them on shortbread biscuits with a chocolate base.
So this is going to give a nice kind of textural contrast to my chocolate bar. So they are now ready for coating in chocolate, but this is no ordinary chocolate coating. This is a beefy coating. So in here, I've got
some melted chocolate. To that, I'm going to add some cocoa butter, some more Wagyu beef fat. Now, ready to coat my chocolate bars. For that classic chocolate bar decorative finish, just going to... So, here it is, inspired by the Victorian meaty chocolate bar. This is my mousse bar. Next.
Wow.
I recruit the nation's most innovative chocolate makers to help me create a monster bar full of surprises. I want to create a show-stopping chocolate bar for my chocolate feast, and I want it to incorporate some of the nation's favourite bars.
Do you love anyone enough to give them your last roller?
But where did our favourite bars come from, and why do we love them so much? I've come to meet branding expert Robert Opie. I'm always going to ask you if you've got any chocolate bars, but I see there's no much shortage here at all, is there?
None at all, and I think you must have one of your favourites from your childhood here, I suspect.
It's this. It's the Pink Panther.
Ugh.
It's the Pink Panther chocolate bar. Wow. OK, so that's completely stopped me in my tracks. Once you see them in their packaging, it just takes you back. The Mars bar.
Yes.
Now, I don't know when this is four pence.
Yes, well, that'll be 70s.
70s.
But they're still using Mars a day helps you work, rest and play.
The first thing I thought when I saw that packet was exactly that. And you go through all of these. You've got the Milky Bars Run Me.
Yep.
The Kit Kat, Have a Break, Have a Kit Kat. Even without knowing it, we've become attached to particular brands.
You're absolutely right. We love it. And it's part of our lives. And that's why we get so nostalgic about it. They come like friends to us. We look forward to them. It gives us comfort, and that's the power of the brand,
yeah.
Because that's what you're familiar with.
The British chocolate industry started branding its bars in the early 1930s, and by the end of the decade, most of our favourite chocolate bars had been invented.
1929 saw the launch of Crunchy Bar. Now, a lot of people are surprised at that. Something really quite technical as a crunchy bar goes back to 1929, and new creations like Aero. What a wonderful idea to put lots of bubbles in.
Yes, if you can sell air.
That's a great thing. But essentially what you're selling in terms of chocolate is the taste sensation.
I want to create my own taste sensation, a giant bar that incorporates a selection of our classic British chocolates. But which ones do I pick?
Dairy Milk.
Toffee Crisp.
Twix.
Mars Bar.
Caramac.
Freddo's. It's got to be Freddo's.
Flake. Boost.
I actually like Maltesers, which is a girl's chocolate, I think.
I brought my stash back to my development kitchen, where the magic happens. Well, sometimes. I want to give my diners a kaleidoscope of chocolate bar tastes, flavours and excitement, but in every bite. But first, I need to know which ones go together best. My chefs and I are going to see who can make the best new bar using the best bits of some old classics. I've got a toffee crisp. I can see a piece of chocolate history being made. Double-decker Aero Flake, Mars, Milky Way and Twix. Bosh.
Crunchy.
After 15 minutes, our competitive spirits are really starting to kick in. I think he's pulled a fast one. Right, now he's gone. Let's sabotage this. And some flake. That's it. So it's time for the judging. I've got a base of Aero, then I've taken the hazelnut filling from a Bueno, layered that on top. Then I've got the biscuit from a Kit Kat. Then I've got the heart from a Bounty. Then I've got the upturned, underside, chewy, biscuity thing from a double-decker.
Actually works.
Doesn't it?
I would buy that.
I'd buy that as well, but then I would say that, wouldn't I?
It's all right, then.
Not bad, is it?
It's like a mouthful of sweet shop.
We have a honeycomb base,
layer of nougat coming from a Twix. Rice crispy on caramel top.
Yeah, that works. The one question I would say with that was, how do you think you could possibly transport that and pack it? Do you know what smart has made this? Interesting thing is, they'll work. If we could get a combination of some of these and these layers with some of the real kind of finesse and delicacy that you can get from a handmade chocolate, we could end up with something pretty special that might even surpass your creation.
Nah, no chance.
I want to include all of our classic chocolate bars, but to do that, I'm going to need to go big, which means I'm going to need some help. I was thinking, what if I could bring some of this country's greatest chocolate makers, from the companies that make our iconic chocolate bars through to the incredible young chocolatiers, kind of taking Britain's chocolate heritage forward, and get them all to contribute to this bar, but leave it up to them, their creativity, their nostalgia, their favourites. I could make the very first great bar of Britain. Hey, Vicky, do me a favour. Can you please make something really delicious for me in chocolate and stick it in there?
We'll have a go.
Thanks. I've had some giant chocolate chunk moulds made, which I'm sending out to chocolate makers big and small across the whole country.
Thank you.
Once they've filled them with their own interpretations of some classic chocolate bars, I'll stick them together to produce the first great bar of Britain. Now it's time to get to work on my chunk, which will be a mix of some of my childhood favourites, but all in one bite. The idea was to take inspiration from some of the iconic chocolate bars and kind of combine them into one. So, here's our chocolate shell. First, in honour of the caramel bar, I'm adding a salted butter caramel sauce with passion fruit that will help cut through the richness of the chocolate. Next, I'm making my tribute to the Mint Aero bar. I've mixed fresh mint, chocolate and cocoa butter. I add bubbles to the mixture using a siphon, and for the final step, I place it in a vacuum machine, which will expand the bubbles even more. Here is the lighter-than-air, minty-aerated chocolate bar that we took out of the vacuum machine, but we've just trimmed it down so it's going to sit into the mould. Using an apple corer, Hideka's just going to remove a tube of aerated chocolate. In those little holes, I'm going to put some mini eggs. I've been inspired by a combination of two classic chocolates. One is the After Eight, and the other one is the cream egg. The shells are made with moulded white chocolate, sprayed with a cocoa glaze. But I also want my eggs to have whites and runny yolks. If I was to fill each half of these eggshells with this quite kind of liquidy fondant, you go to put them together and it'll just pour out. So I'm using a trick borrowed from the makers of After Eight. You used to wonder, how do you make After Eights? The centre's really soft, gooey, it's almost pourable. How do you coat it in chocolate? And the way they used to do it, something like this, which is called fondant, and then you add to this fondant something called invertase. And it's an enzyme that snips away at the sugars. It breaks them down. Over time, the enzyme changes the squidgy fondant into a runny liquid, and that is exactly what I want to do with my egg whites. So, take the fondant, where the enzyme has been added, but it's only just been added, form it into an egg white. For the yolk, I've made an apricot and peach jelly. Yeah, and then I just pop the two halves together. And so what happens is the invertase starts to break the fondant down. A few days later, you have the perfect runny egg. Just take the egg. Once the eggs are in place, I'm adding my versions of milk and dark chocolate flakes. It's kind of a Hall of Fame rectangle of chocolate. There's an element of aero, there's an element of cream egg, there's an element of After Eight, there's an element of flake. And I'm not finished yet. So this is a malt nougat. It's Milky Way. There's some more caramel. So the final layer is the biscuit, so that you've got the biscuit and the caramel together make Twix. Sealed with a layer of chocolate and allowed to cool, it's ready to go. So here is my lacquered chocolate rectangle of minty, aero, cream egg, after eight, Twix, Mars bar, Milky Way, flaky type, chocolate bar type thing. And it isn't long before my army of chocolatiers start sending me their own interpretations of our great British classics. Look at that. This might be the most expensive bar of whole nut in the world. Dairy Milk.
Wow.
From a Scottish chunk inspired by the Milky Bar to a Turkish delight creation from London, the nation's chocolatiers have done me proud.
Oh, that's cool.
But not all of the chunks have survived the journey unscathed.
That's not great news.
But all is not lost. With a fresh coating of chocolate, my team ensure any cracks are repaired and my great bar of Britain is soon looking its best. Next, I create a romantic chocolate box with a big surprise. Since its earliest days, chocolate has been considered a food of love.
Take it easy with Cadbury's Caramel.
The first chocolate boxes were created in the 1860s, and ever since they've been one of the most popular romantic gifts to give to your loved one.
And all because the lady loves milk tray.
For the main event at my chocolate banquet, I want to create my own romantic chocolate box. I'm travelling to the 1860s, when the chocolate box and love first became a couple. Right, I'm in need of a little bit of inspiration for my chocolate box. So, I've come to the people that brought the box of chocolates to the masses. Cadbury's were amongst the first chocolate box pioneers, and they've been producing chocolate selections for almost 150 years.
Hey, how are you doing?
I'm in the archives of Cadbury's with Tony Billsborough to learn more about their earliest selections.
So, these were the very first chocolate boxes?
Yeah, one of the first chocolate boxes in the world.
Price-wise, if you brought somebody this for a gift, I mean, was that something you do to impress, or is somebody that you kind of felt a lot for? Or...
Absolutely, it's not an everyday gift. Some of these, I mean, they're magnificent designs, probably costing, actually, at the time, over £1.
In 1860, a common labourer was lucky to earn £10 in a year. It wasn't until Cadbury's launched Milk Tray in 1915 that an affordable chocolate box became available.
When a young man gave this to his girlfriend, it was almost akin to a marriage proposal. It was that expensive, and if she received this, she knew she was truly someone special. It certainly isn't something you handed over as a thank you for looking after the cat, for instance. In many respects, the chocolate is playing second fiddle to the box itself. It's all about the packaging.
I came here for an inspiration from a chocolate box. I didn't really think about the box itself, because, I mean, we're just used to cardboard boxes of chocolates today. Actually, look at these. I mean, they're so intricate. Somehow, I've got to kind of take some of the opulence and the sort of craftsmanship and surprise from these into my box of chocolates.
But while I think about the box, I also need to decide what chocolates to put inside it. I want to give my guests a selection of chocolates they will never forget.
The exciting thing for me in this country is that right now, today, there's a new wave of British chocolatiers pushing the boundaries of what's possible with chocolate.
I've been combining chocolate with unusual ingredients since I started out as a chef. I'm here to meet chocolatier Paul A. Young, who's carrying on this experimental tradition.
Hey, Paul.
Hi, how are you doing? I'm good, how are you?
Yeah, I'm good, thanks. Have you noticed a big difference in people's kind of confidence and level of adventure in terms of the kind of unusual flavours and textures that you're putting in your chocolates?
Definitely. So on the tray here, we've got the classics, a classic dark truffle, a champagne truffle. A classic now is salted caramel. 8 years ago, as you know, salted caramel was why on earth would you put salt in caramel? But now it's become every day. So my customers now come in and they'll say, right, I'll have a classic truffle in my box of four, and I'll have that. That's my two classics. Then I'll get really adventurous. I'll have one of my new favourites, the marmalade and brown toast.
Oh, that sounds good.
And a cigar leaf caramel.
I used to have these on the duck. It's beautiful, actually.
And you get the warmth and the nicotine at the back of the throat. This one, Seville's were in January, made of marmalade, and the ganache, the creamy filling, is brown toast blitzed into the chocolate.
But it's exactly
it
what you taste.
You know, rhubarb and pink peppercorn. It's seasonal, everybody knows those ingredients, but would they normally put them together in a chocolate?
Yeah, it's fantastic. So how important is texture to you, your chocolates?
Texture's huge. Texture, appearance and flavour. Chocolate is generally different shades of brown. Yeah. It's not the most exciting colour in the world. So if I just put four chocolates with different textures, if they're in a box, you're eating through them, you're going to get a different experience every time. You've got to have different textures in a chocolate box now. Very important.
These flavours, they're so pure and clear, you can taste them, is that people can't get enough of them.
There's a revolution in chocolate at the minute, especially in the UK. I think we are, generally in the UK, the most adventurous for flavour as consumers and the most adventurous as chefs and chocolatiers and patissiers for innovation.
That was brilliant. What a great example of how our love of chocolate is booming, our level of adventure is booming. But we also love the nostalgic stuff. So I know that I've got to capture the range of textures, a range of flavours, and some excitement and surprise in my box of chocolates. I was amazed when I saw those old original chocolate boxes. I mean, they really were like works of art. So I wanted to make a chocolate box, but where the box is made of chocolate. So for the lid and the size of the box, I've had a transfer made. In here, I've just got some white chocolate.
I'm going to spread a very thin layer of chocolate over my edible transfer. When it's set, I'll cut the sides of the box out and glue them together with some melted white chocolate.
Pipe along one edge, and then on the two vertical edges of this side panel. And you've got to work pretty quickly. The chocolate's so thin, and my hands are pretty warm. You don't want to melt the chocolate. So there is the lid of my chocolate box.
Now to turn my attention to the chocolates themselves.
So I'm going to only be making four chocolates for my chocolate box. Within those four chocolates, I want them to have all of the textures you can possibly ever imagine, and some of them that you might not expect.
So I'll be making a crumbly, aerated chocolate with mandarin and rose water, topped with a lime jelly, a smooth, centered, spicy ganache with popping candy, a soft malt caramel with a crispy puff malt sphere, and finally, a crunchy chocolate wrapped biscuit with a coconut syrup liquid center.
The first chocolate I'm going to make is a little mini cocoa bean. So here I've got a mould. In one side, I'm going to pipe in some ganache. Ganache is a mixture of chocolate and cream. I've infused chilli, some aniseed, some cardamom and some cinnamon.
The other half of my cocoa bean is going to be filled with chocolate-coated popping candy to give my guests an unexpected mouth crackle. Something I first experimented with in chocolate desserts at my restaurant in the 1990s.
And what I loved about this is you see some really serious adults in the restaurant, and all of a sudden their eyes would just do this, and they have just a massive grin on their faces. They found the surprise of all this amazing crackling sensation in their mouth. Just great seeing adults being reduced to kids.
Just to put the two halves together, I'm going to heat a palette knife, just using a blowtorch. And then just, you can see it's melted the chocolate. And then, there.
So that's glued the chocolate cocoa pod together, and that is ready to go into my chocolate box. Okay, so for my next chocolate, I am going to make a chocolate box classic.
To start off, I'm going to pipe a salted butter caramel with a hint of malt vinegar into a chocolate mould.
That malt vinegar is going to give this really beautiful acidity that'll just kind of, although this is rich, will still make it mouth-watering. Instead of the nut in the centre,
What I've done here is made my version of Maltesers. You take some malt syrup and malt powder. Then you add some bicarbonate of soda, which is kind of the way you make honeycomb. We then put it in a vacuum machine and then it expands those bubbles. So it makes these really kind of light, textured crunch to it. Then it's coated in chocolate to the center. And then for another textural variation, this is caramelized hazelnuts, which will add another texture. And then finally, I need to just seal them with some chocolate. So I just need to leave these chocolates in a cool place now to set, and then I can unmold them.
Once it's set, all my chocolate needs is a wrapper.
Now, this is no ordinary wrapper, because it's edible. So here's my version of a chocolate box classic. I'm going to call it the lilac one.
My edible chocolate box, complete with the ultimate chocolate selection. It's the perfect romantic gift. Finally, I want to create a decadent chocolate aperitif for my chocolate feast. And there's a recipe from the 1660s that may be the perfect inspiration.
Now, us Brits, we love chocolate. We eat tons of the stuff. But our love of chocolate didn't start off with us eating it. It started off with us drinking it.
I'm travelling back to 17th century London. Back then, London was an exciting cosmopolitan city. Chocolate was served in exclusive chocolate houses, a cross between a cafe, pub and a gentleman's club. I've come to meet food historian Annie Gray, who's going to help me create a classic 17th century chocolate tipple.
So I have to take these cocoa nibs. These are the beans which have been roasted.
When the English first discovered these, they discovered them on Spanish ships and they thought they were sheep poo and dropped them overboard.
Tastes chocolatey, definitely, but it's bitter.
It's served for us hot, sweetened, with lots of spice and sometimes milk or brandy. Absolutely beautiful.
The nibs were ground into a powder on a stone slab called a matate. And just like the early chocolate bars, this chocolate was lauded for its health-giving properties.
Chocolate starts off as a medicine, so it will cure your headaches. It is widely thought to cure male impotence and to, as they say, bring the sap.
It does smell delicious.
It's got a really nice, almost burnt note to it. It's lovely.
We're adding chilli, cloves, aniseed and cinnamon.
So liquid-wise, it would have been mostly water.
It's discovered quite quickly that you get a much better consistency with milk. And then inevitably, because everybody drinks a lot of brandy, we try adding brandy to it.
You just tell me when to stop. How much would they have added?
Quite a lot, I think. Yeah, half and half, probably. I mean, we can probably stop when we want to. You might want to stop now.
I could probably ignite my breath with that. It's chocolatey. The spices come through. The chili kicks a little bit of a gives it a bit of a kick, and then I think I've just pickled myself. If you think about it as a hot chocolate, then I think it might give you a little bit of a shock. If you think about it as a warm, kind of chocolate scented alcoholic hot toddy, then it's quite different. Cheers.
So to kick off my chocolate celebration, I'm making a selection of chocolate aperitifs, starting with an alcoholic hot chocolate based on a classic Black Forest gâteau.
I have a pan of milk to which I'm going to add a little bit of instant coffee just to add an extra little bitter note.
To this mixture, I'm adding vanilla salt and orange, lemon and lime zest. In another pan, I have a mix of milk and dark chocolate.
So now for one of the key ingredients, Black Forest gâteau, booze. And in this case, it's kirsch.
Kirsch is a spirit distilled from cherries and cherry stones.
I want to top that with my take on the whipped cream that you pipe onto the top of a hot chocolate. So in here, I've got a mixture of some cream, some kirsch, and just a little bit of white truffle. Grated chocolate. So here is my 17th century inspired
Black Forest Gatto hot chocolate.
But I'm not finished there. I'm making a chocolate-based cocktail.
I'm going to use some of this chocolate water.
To make it, I've grated chocolate into a pan of hot water. Poured into a flask, it's heated again in a warm bath. Using a vacuum, I'm able to make the chocolate mixture boil at a very low temperature, preserving the flavour of the chocolate. The steam from this mixture rises, and when it reaches this cooled coil, it turns back into a liquid and drips down into a container, creating a perfectly distilled chocolate essence.
When you taste it, it's really quite strange. It has the taste of chocolate. It even has the sort of richness in terms of the flavour of chocolate. However, it has the texture and cleanliness of water. So this is the heart of my new cocktail. So in the beaker, I have a bit of vodka. Just going to add a green olive, then my chocolate water.
And to that, I'm adding a shot of chili gin, vermouth, and some Lapsang Souchong tea syrup to add a delicate smoked flavour.
To finish off, a straw of white chocolate. And there it is.
I'll also be serving a chocolate-infused red wine and chocolate beer. Next, it's time to serve my chocolate feast.
Gorgeous.
And my giant bar of Britain is revealed to the public.
Who's up for chocolate? Yeah!
It's the day of my great chocolate feast, and I've invited some of the nation's chocolate lovers to an experience they'll never forget.
I got a golden ticket.
Greetings to you, the lucky holder of this golden ticket from Heston Blumenthal.
Present this ticket at the entrance to Somerset House.
In your wildest dreams, you cannot imagine the chocolate extravaganza that awaits you.
And where better to stage my romantic chocolate feast than London's Somerset House?
To celebrate our rich and utterly delicious history of chocolate and all the love a box of chocolates can bring, I was thinking, what if I could make a box of chocolates big enough for the whole of Britain to enjoy?
I'll be serving my guests a three-course chocolate-inspired feast in my own pop-up chocolate box restaurant.
It's massive.
Very big.
Awesome.
Welcome to my chocolate box.
I feel like I'm in the 1920s. Very decadent. A little bit naughty.
Imagine just as a chocolate box.
Good afternoon, everyone. So I now officially declare my chocolate box restaurant is open for business.
I'm very excited.
Intrigued by moves.
Yeah. Is this a cow?
Beef.
I am a vegetarian, but I am going
to
give it a go.
As my guests are seated, it's time to offer them a drink from the bar.
Ooh. Ooh. Ooh.
Tom Cruise, move over. This is HB on the mic.
First up, my chocolate water cocktail.
Wow.
Oh, wow.
At least the drinks are going down as planned.
That is gorgeous. Really like some amazing flavours going on there, from smoky, chilli. It's beautiful.
Sweet and smooth and velvety and very Moorish.
Can I interest you in some chocolate wine?
Certainly can.
That is so smooth.
Next, my chocolate beer.
Oh, it's a good
kind of gorgeous.
You can imagine being served that in a pub, in a proper English pub.
And finally, my Black Forest Gatto hot chocolate. And for an extra wow, I'm adding a chocolate essence with a cloud pourer.
Oh my God, that's so good.
Pure decadence. Absolutely delicious.
Who needs a man when you've got Hestons drinks?
With my drinks a big hit, it's time to unleash the Moose Bar.
Chocolate lovers? Yay! Now it's time for the chocolate bar.
I'm wondering where the beef is.
It doesn't smell of beef.
It's so good because it's salty. And sweet and salty. Oh, that mixture is amazing.
You can see the nougat and then the caramel bit on top of it. You can really taste beef.
More cow!
It's more than what I expect from Hestons. I think that's amazing to get meat into a chocolate bar.
I am a veggie, but I'm going to give it a go. I've never eaten meat in my life.
It's really delicious.
And now for the romantic main event. My chocolate box.
It says, nothing says I love you like a box of chocolates, and nothing says wow like Hestons chocolate box surprise.
It's our 5-year anniversary today.
Chocolate's the best way to celebrate, really.
Your chocolate box?
It's stunning.
It just looks like a jewellery box. It's
opulent, isn't it?
Special.
Yeah.
Oh, God.
I would say I do if I was given that.
Yeah.
On offer in my chocolate box is a pâte de fruit, spicy ganache, lime in coconut, and of course, my big lilac one.
That's pretty good.
I feel a little bit weird.
You don't like it good.
Oh my God, fantastic.
Oh my.
Really, really unique.
It's bizarre.
Really weird. It's like I'm eating plastic, but I'm not.
That's a spicy ganache.
Oh.
Oh, my God.
Wow.
It just goes.
Started popping candy.
Has it?
There's crackling, there's like almost peppery spice.
That is, put the lime in our coconut. That's
for sure. Put it in my coconut any day.
And my guests have just discovered my chocolate box's hidden secret.
Anybody?
Oh, yes, that's it.
This is how all chocolate boxes should be. You should be able to eat the box.
Even the menu card is edible.
I feel like I'm a kid again.
So romantic. Yeah, really.
I think if somebody gave me this chocolate box, I would accept.
And finally, it's time to unveil my grand finale, the Great Bar of Britain.
Chocolate bar that big.
This is amazing.
Who's up for chocolate? Yeah! Chisel, hammer.
Look at that.
We're kids, aren't we, when chocolate comes back? It's what it's all about. So, yeah, give me more.
There's so many textures going on. There's so many different things. It's like a chocolate overload.
That's ours.
Hestons, amazing. It had these like liquids and some sort of fruit jelly, and they sort of like exploded in your mouth. And then aerated white chocolate, I think it's mint. And then I've eaten it all, but it had some praline and some salted caramel and some flakes in dark chocolate. And now I feel sick.
Yummy. From the start to the finish, from the drinks to the chocolate box to the giant bar of chocolate, it's just more than anyone could have imagined.
It's the best one ever. It's chocolate and it's fantastic and it's in a magical box.
I mean, heaven. Definitely captured the fun and excitement of chocolate. It's been real.
What I love about Hestons is mixed the heritage of British chocolate, so all the history of what it really means, but now he's brought the fun of what it's all about. We're back to being kids again now, and that's absolutely fantastic.
So of all the iconic British dishes or foods, at first glance, chocolate wouldn't really be near the top of the list. Yeah, curry and fish and chips, but chocolate? But when I started looking into the history, I realised, actually, This country changed the world of chocolate. And looking at this today, we are more in love with chocolate than we've ever been. And that, for me, is a fantastic thing.